So it's a pleasure to be on this nice conference. So thank you, Kerry, for the invitation. And to the few people in the room that attended the talk I gave here 2 years ago, I think, maybe. This is a continuation of the work that I presented last time I was here with some of the main collaborators, Emil, that I mean, talked in this conference a few days ago, John Donoghue, Barry Holstein, and my PhD student, Ludovic Planté, where we look at quantum gravity process between massive and massless object in pure gravity using amplitude techniques. And as the title mentions, we will see at the end of the talk that when we look at some process when we scatter massless states against a massive state by only computing gravitational interaction, but really quantizing this interaction by including one loop corrections, there will be an issue about interpreting the result, and I will have something to say about what happens to the equivalence principle in this context. So, we still poorly understand quantum gravity, right? So, in November we will celebrate the 100 year anniversary of Einstein's classical theory of gravity. A year after, in 1916, he already understood that you need to quantize the gravitational field the same way you have to quantize the electromagnetic field for the stability of the atom. So he had made the usual computation of the loss of energy by gravitational radiation in atom. He found that, of course, the time is huge, compared to the age of the universe, but nevertheless, he concluded that you need to quantize gravity. So still today, we are fighting with this. We have methods to do it, but we still need to, to convince ourselves that this plays a role in the way we think about the present universe. So the talk today will be a very modest, few modest computations that shows that actually we can try to go into this direction of understanding what some properties, elementary properties of quantum gravity, and in particular, at some point, I will tell about detection of single gravitons, and so, which is an interesting question. So, anyway, so since this is an the title of this conference is called Graviton Scattering, so I will scatter gravitons, and I will use amplitude techniques in my computation. And so, and the place where I will be working will be essentially in the context of low energy field theory. So since I'm working with pure gravity, there is no miracle. So pure gravity is badly behaved at high energy. And so there is a priori the problem of UV divergences, and as you know, that is an issue if you really are sensitive to the high energy physics. But the thing that I want to focus is something that was started a long time ago by John Donoghue, where you take this point of view of treating Einstein gravity, and we just be quantizing the gravitational field, in the context of a low energy effective field theory. So I will be interested by only the low energy field, infrared physics. So I will explain in a minute. What happens to the the way I separate the infrared from the UV, and this is an important point as well, is that I am working with the standard quantum field theory approach, where I have a clear will be able to separate infrared and UV. There are other theories that you can think of. Quantum gravity, where there's some UV IR mixing, so I don't have anything to say about that. And but the important point that I will be using is that to the order that I'm going to compute in that talk, and actually, there are some more computation that I'm doing with my student that goes beyond what I'm saying in the talk. The infrared contribution will only be depending on pretty much on the structure of the classical tree or the classical theory, and will be independent on the UV completion. So this is one important point you should keep in your head, that I'm going to be independent of the UV completion. So essentially, one of the problems that I want to address is the following. So this is the very, you know, very famous question of the light bending. So you have here a source, emits a photon, this is a massless field, and it travels through the curved space, and the geodesic is not a straight line. It's bent by the sun, so I want to redo that using amplitude method. So I want to compute this using Feynman graphs. So one graviton exchange will be tree level, two graviton two loop, etc. And I want as well to have not only the classical aspect of it, but as well the quantum part. So that means I want to see what is the effect of quantizing the gravitational field. And so this is what we have done recently, and this is the new thing compared to the talk I gave 2 years ago. So what is the setup? So as I said, so the setup is just Einstein-Hilbert action, which, and the, so when you linearize that, that gives you the kinetic term for the graviton. So the graviton is denoted H mu nu. It couples the matter through the minimal coupling, so the stress energy tensor, T mu nu. And I will have here, so the lines, either solid or dotted lines, are my external states, so the object that I'm scattering. So in that case, the sun or the photon. But the only thing I want to look at is the exchange of gravitational field. So all the things I'm exchanging, one graviton or multi-graviton exchange, and here you see I'm including loops because I'm quantizing the interaction with the graviton field. So if in a S-matrix approach, I'm going to have the usual sum of tree level, one loop, two loops, etc. So, and clearly, H bar is my quantum parameter, so tree level is 1 over H bar, one loop is H bar to the 0, etc., etc. From the, for example, the single graviton exchange, that is the tree amplitude, so you have a single, your graviton propagates, you have the 1 over Q square poles. When you take the non-relativistic limit, if you have two massive states, yeah, you can take the non-relativistic limit, and you have to reget, at least at the first order, the Newton's law, so the classical Newton law. So in the non-relativistic limit, you know the stress energy tensor essentially gives you the mass square of each of your massive particles. There's kappa square for each vertices, and kappa square is Newton's constant, 1 over Q square, and then you get the potential by doing the Fourier transform of the momentum transfer in three dimension, and you get the usual 1 over R potential. Okay, so this is the way you get from the tree the classical bit. Okay, everybody is happy. Now, the thing that is more surprising is the following fact, is that suppose now I have here a massive particle. And here this is a graviton loop. So I emit a graviton, I make the graviton interact, it reabsorbs, and then the graviton goes away, and then there is something happens. So you can see that, you can think that, for example, it's like an effective correction to, it's an effective coupling with a one loop gravitational interaction here. Now, suppose this external leg is a scalar, phi. It satisfies the Klein-Gordon equation. Okay, so that means it boxes phi, but because it's a massive state, here you have 1 over the inverse Planck length of your field. So that means the mass divided by h bar square. So now this is going to be important, because if you compute that one loop amplitude, so it's a triangle graph. So if I'm in 4 dimensions, I have one loop momentum, and look at the integral where there is no numerator, I have here the propagators. I have two massless propagators. I have a massive propagator. Yeah. If you analyze that integral, of course, that integral is divergent. I mean, but the point is that if you just look at the finite part, which is, so I'm dropping the epsilon part. I will comment on the epsilon part later. The finite part contains two pieces. It contains the part that is the log S. So S is P1 plus P2 square. And it contains the square root part. It has infrared divergences. I mean, it has one over, it has some infrared divergences, this one. So I think this one has infrared divergences, right? Or, OK, anyway. So the point what I want to say is that in this graph, you know, in the non-relativistic limit, has two contributions to, two contributions. One is log S, one is square root of S. So the general formula involves something like a square root of the threshold, which is 4m squared divided by s, and there is a d logarithm. There is some logarithm function here that come in. But the point is that so this part here and this part are very different because you see because of the fact that here you have the quantum length that is involved. There is one over h bar that comes with the mass. So as you see when you sum this one loop contribution to the tree level contribution, the log S has no h bar, so it counts what you count one loop, but the mass of a square root has one over h bar. So it will go with the tree level part. So in fact, what I'm saying is actually a very generic feature, is that it has nothing to do with the fact that I'm looking at gravity theory. So even if you look at QED and you have an electron and your photons, or if you take when you take a non-relativistic limit, you can project, I mean, a subpart of your amplitude just on the classical contributions. But for the case that we are interested in terms of gravity, this part will be the classical part that will be. So you will convert by looking at the power of h bar something that is an expansion in terms of the mass and by Fourier transform that will correspond to the classical post-Newtonian expansion. So essentially, the classical part I'm getting from the multi-loop amplitude will give me the post-Newtonian expansion in harmonic gauge. And the quantum part that comes together, because these two objects are tied together by the fact that it's the same interval that gives rise to them, is a quantum part. And now, if you look at the discontinuity of this graph, you see that you should see a discontinuity that is a log S, a discontinuity that is a square root. And that is one of very important ingredients in this type of computation. And in a sense, okay, so the square root of S gives me Q. So then I have an expansion. If I have two masses, that is the tree-level term I told you in the non-relativistic limit, the usual Newton's potential. And then you have a term that is coming from this one-loop triangle, and h-bar is in front. So everybody is of the same order in h-bar. And then you have the loop corrections here. And if you do that for when you scatter a massless particle characterized by energy E on a massive target. And since I still have a massive leg, I can play the same. And so there is an asymmetry between the two. But nevertheless, I still have the classical tree. And then I still have a classical thing that comes from the one loop, where essentially the mass is replaced by the energy. Right? So in a sense, so what I'm saying now is that if you are powerful enough to do this computation to all loop order, you should be able to reproduce the post-Newtonian expansion to any order. And it's a check of the computation. So in a sense, at one loop, the computation I will show you, I mean, is done using a few tricks. So you can make sure you are doing the right computation in a really simple way. But suppose you start to do this and you compute what corresponds to a for loop amplitude. For loop being for loop of gravitons. You extract the classical bit the way I explain. You should, checking that it gives you the correct post-Newtonian correction is a way to check the validity of your computation. Of course, before that, since I have constructed an amplitude, I would have made all the check that we learn that are safely checked on amplitudes, I mean infrared and cuts and things like that, but at least it's another check on the top of it. So,
Pierre?
Yes?
Is there a way to reorder the calculation so that you can disentangle the quantum and classical parts?
Yes, so there is a way, actually, I noticed that, to my knowledge, it has not been written explicitly in the literature, but you can realize that there's a way you can rescale the field so that you can completely take a limit and kill the quantum part and project on the classical part. And essentially, you know, if you think in terms of word lines, and so then you can get an effective type of Lagrangian that describes that, that computes only the classical part, and this is what the effective one-body approach people do. They compute multi-loop because they exchange multi-gravitons, but they only get the classical part. They don't get the quantum part.
Can you then do one loop around that and get all orders in the classical physics and first order nature?
Yeah, so the point is that the amplitude is only the way you can keep the two, the classical and the quantum.
Yes.
So the cross diagram. So in a sense,
you know, where you have non-planar. Oh,
but the point is that yeah, I'm not.
Or is it just ladders, straight ladders?
Okay, so I will be looking at this, and I will have M1, M2. So, but this includes graphs like that as well, right? And that includes everything. I mean, includes everything you can write. So the only thing I care is that I have here something that is graviton interaction only. And then you have your lines here of your mass, M1, M2, or it can be massless. And here, everything you can think in terms of being the diagram that contributes to the multi-loop is going to so for example, at two-loop, there will be guys like that, and but there will be as well... there is a guy like that with all possible crossing and, you know, everything you can think of. I mean, so there's no restriction. I mean, okay. Of course, it has to be the amplitude, the natural amplitude you want to construct. Okay. And the only thing I'm not looking at, I will not be interested about, you know, when I look at unitarity about the cut in that channel because there are massive cuts, but I will be only looking at massive. Otherwise, you have to put everything you want. Okay, so if I Fourier transform this expression here, so since I'm in four dimensions, the leading tree level gives me 1 over r, the next one, 1 over r squared, and the log, when I Fourier transform the log in respect to the three-dimensional space-time, I get 1 over r cubed, so there's 1 over r, so 1 over r, 1 over r squared, 1 over r cubed. And the thing that would normally contribute to the UV divergence is normally something that is local in the momentum. So the local in momentum space, the UV divergence are local. So when you Fourier transform, it's a delta function. Okay. So in a sense, this is why you see, as I was telling you, the separation between what is long range and short range. So UV is short range. And I will be focusing on that part that is the long-range part. And a very, very elementary way to understand the origin of this quantum correction as being associated to the classical one. So I told you the two guys come together from this loop amplitude, and at higher loop is the same, is by doing the following. Suppose you have a classical contribution, and yeah, the power of R could be higher if you look at higher post-Newtonian expansion. Then you decide that actually you have an uncertainty on the position R given by the quantum wavelength, that is h bar divided by the typical mass of your system. So if you have two massive objects, it's M1 plus M2, but if you have just a photon and a sun, it would be just h bar divided by the mass of the sun. You do a first order expansion here, and you see that actually the mass is going to combine such that I'm getting back h bar. So this is doing the opposite of what I did from the amplitude. So the h bar that I'm getting from the amplitude here, so this is the thing that the h bar that is relative to the tree. So you understand that actually the relative factor that h bar you get when you do respect to the tree, when you do higher loop expansion, is completely sucked up by actually this very sleek argument of thinking that actually the quantum correction is associated with some uncertainty on the classical part. Okay, I'm just saying something very trivial, is that the Schwarzschild radius of a black hole times the quantum wavelength is the square of the Planck length. Okay, so, and this is what this computation does. So, no. So the structure of what we are looking at now, I mean, I don't like to work so much in coordinate space because there are issues about defining the potential. So it's better to try to work with gauge invariant object, amplitude and cross section. So this is what I will do. So the message is that essentially in this talk I will be looking at these two quantum corrections that are square root type and log type, and through the cut I will be detecting them. And the UV part is a local contribution to the amplitude that is normally associated to higher derivative correction to your effective action, and that I don't have to compute because, I mean, in a sense, in what I'm going to say, you will see I will miss pieces in my amplitude. But the pieces I'm going to miss will have to do with higher powers of loop momenta that have to do with the UV behavior. But I will be extracting correctly the piece that will give me the correct infrared. So this is an important insight because in a way you don't have to construct the full amplitude. You can just focus on the part that you are interested in. And the coefficients C and Q, what is important, are independent of the UV completion. So let's do the computation in. So this is the thing I told you. So this is the single graviton exchange in momentum space in the non-relativistic limit. This is the expressions. So now I want to go to one loop. So I want to go to have a massive particle M1, M2, and I exchange two gravitons. So the natural way to do it is to do the two graviton cuts and sticking two trees that I'm going to merge by integrating over the phase space across the cut. So that means I have to compute the tree-level amplitude, which is a particle of mass M1 and spin M1, spin S1, that emits two gravitons. So it's the same particle that comes and exits and emits two gravitons, and I have to know what is this tree amplitude. So if you do that using the standard Feynman rules, you have to sum. It's the gravitational Compton scattering, and you have to sum a few graphs. It's complicated. I mean, you can do it using Feynman graphs, but it's complicated to do. So the best way to do that is to use actually the squaring relation that you have heard, the fact that you can express the gravity tree amplitude as the square of two Young-Mills tree amplitude, using a function that depends only on the momenta of the external state, that we call the momentum kernel, which expression S is given by this. It only depends on the scalar product of the external momenta. And the advantage of that is that, so what I want to say is that this expression that you have certainly encountered before in various incarnations, it started with the work of Kawai, Lowell, and Tai, was derived in string theory where a priori you have massless external states. So normally, it's a formula that has to do with massless external states, string theory, supergravity, whatever you want. But here, I'm talking about pure gravity. I'm talking about massive states. So the thing that you have to realize is actually this relation is valid even if you have massive states. And the reason is, it is simple. Is that in a sense when you if you write k1 dot k2 times it's k1 k2 square minus m1 square minus m2 square. So if this is a massless particle, this the relation between the dot product and the Monoshian variables is immediate. But if this is massive, you see that you have to keep the mass. But if you keep everything in terms of dot product, all the formula don't change. So it's very important that you never that you keep the dot product between the external momenta in the expression of the momentum kernel, and then the formula doesn't change if you go massless and massive. Another way to justify that the formula is still valid for massless and massive is that this is a three amplitude relation, and a massive particle in four dimensions is a massless particle in higher dimension, and this three amplitude doesn't know about the dimension when you derive it, so it has to be the same. And if you are a string theorist, you realize that actually this relation comes from monodromy properties of the amplitude, the string theory amplitude, where here you have the product of the plane wave that gives you these factors, and whether or not you have massless or massive external states has to do with the prefactor here, that has to do with the kind of excited state you look from the string theory point of view. But this prefactor is some integer power of the difference of the position of the vertex operators. And there is no branch cut. So all the interesting monodromy properties of that object come from that factor. And this factor is universal whether you are massive or massless. So having said that, then I can look at my compound gravitational scattering. So I have a particle of mass m and spin s. So the spin can be 0, 1 half, and I emit two gravitons. So KLT tells me that it's going to be the product of the momentum kernel associated with that process, that is just p1.k1. So p1 is the momentum of my massive particle, and k is the momentum of one of the gravitons. And here, the color-ordered amplitude. So here, this is the color-ordered amplitude where you emit two gluons from, so you have the equivalent Young-Mills process where you emit two gluons from your charge, your massive state, and this is for the scalar. So you factorize, so only one Young-Mills amplitude knows about the spin of your particle, and the other one is a scalar. So it's the way the double copy works. The thing that is very interesting is that if you use the properties of this, the monodromy properties of this color ordered amplitude, you can permute the various channel, and you can rewrite it in a way that looks a bit more complicated, where here I have a rational function of the external momenta. But here you see the ordering is the same for the two factors. So it's not clear I have gained anything. But the place where I've gained really something is that actually by choosing correctly my channel here, I have reduced, so the amplitude here, that normally KLT tells you you factorize gravity on the product of two QCD amplitude. So it's non-abelian. So a priori, you have to include the interaction between the gluons. Here, what happens is that if you choose your channel, you can kill the diagram where the gluon interact, and you are left with these graphs. And because you are here keeping the same spin, and you are not changing the spin and the mass and of this particle, essentially, you can see that the color factor just factorized naturally out of this thing. And so it's in a way, you can focus on abelian sector of your Young-Mills theory. And so the result is that this gravitational compound scattering up to this factor that is not as nice as in the previous slides is the product of the two QED one. And there's a lot to do from that. So what is the first consequence of that? So this graviton amplitude, because it's the square of the QED one, then you know I can look at the soft properties of the right-hand side and understand what is the soft properties of the left-hand side. So there have been a few talks in this conference about what are the soft properties of the gravitational amplitude. But you see, it's completely immediate. So you know that from the classical work on QED that this guy goes like pi square. Because it's the square, actually, it's not difficult to see when you take the limit that actually the gravitational compound scattering is exact up to the order pi to the fourth. It's really no effort. I mean, it's really just an application of that formula, and that's very a trivial consequence. If you look at the way it was, the same result was derived a long time ago by these people, I mean, the analysis is much more complicated. So no, the point is that when you will go to wire loop, you will want to emit multigravitons, okay? So this game I've been playing will be extremely important. Of course, I'm not claiming that if I emit a high number of gravitons, I will be able to have everything that is abelian, because already from the soft behavior, you understand it's not going to be possible. But nevertheless, there's a lot of simplification. So in a sense, if you want to do this computation to wire loop, the first recipe is to play with this relation and to simplify as much as possible the structure of your tree, which is doable. So, but before going to loop, let's look at what I can do with this quantum tree, gravitational quantum amplitude. So from my gravitational quantum amplitude, I can look at the cross section. Okay, so the quantum scattering, actually, I can look at what is the low energy limit. So I look at the quantum scattering of the particle of mass m and spin s, and I take the non-relativistic limit. And this is just a photon. So the photon, it's my target. The photon goes there. The target is, moves, and there's the angle here. So you know, there is a universal low energy limit. Alpha is the charge square, and there is this dependence on the angles. Okay, and then there are corrections that depends. The multiple expansion in time. That's suppressed by 1 over m, the mass of the particle. But in the low energy limit, this is universal. There is no memory of the spin here. Okay? The same for scalar, spin 1 half, spin 1. So this is what you know from QED. And the small angle limit, if you take the forward limit, theta equals 0, this is just e squared divided by 8 pi m squared. Okay? It's just, I take theta equals 0 in that formula. And this is dominated by this graph. So let's do it for the gravity case. So here, now I have a graviton that hits a target. And essentially, the cross-section is going to be the square of the previous one because of the KLT relation I showed you. And that you find by exactly this simple KLT relation that the low-energy limit is as well universal because this prefactor here doesn't depend on the spin. It's a little more complicated because you have to square the relation. So the dependence on the angle, on the scattering angle, is, you see, there is this cotangent to the fourth that corrects it. But nevertheless, it's unexpected. It's independent of the spin, as in the QED case. Now, what you do is that if you look at the small angle scattering, so what happens is that what you find is that you find that actually when theta goes to 0, it goes like 1 over theta to the fourth. And this is the usual Rutherford scattering. This is the square of the Schwarzschild radius divided by theta to the fourth. And it's dominated by a graph that doesn't show, that is the graviton pole. Okay? So it's the usual 1 over r potential. And you have the standard forward limit for the cross-section. Now, look at the following process, because that process exists. You have a graviton that hits your target and emits a photon. Or maybe you can read it in a different way. You have a photon that emits a graviton. Okay? So it's a mixed process, graviton-photon. I can compute the cross-section, the amplitude in the same way. I still have KLT relations. And KLT still give me something that is expressed in terms of completely QED amplitude. There is a prefactor that is given by this. So you have to think a little more, because here you have a spin 2. So here is a spin 2, is a spin 1. So you have the color order amplitude for the, which is the emission of two gluons. In that case, that would be two photons from your target of mass m and spin s. But the point, you have to do something with the... So since there's only one polarization, it's a rank 1 polarization, it's rank 2, you still have to do with the overpolarization of the graviton. So this guy goes into the prefactorial. Okay. So when you write, because it's a spin two, so this is the field strength associated, if you want, with the right moving part of your graviton. So this is why the formula looks a bit different from before, but anyway, it's still QED times the kinematical prefactor. So if you look at this, then you find again that the graviphoto production is universal in the non-relativistic limit, is independent of the spin. But the dependence, so no, it contains Newton's constant, it contains the charge of the particle. But the angles, you see, there is some the formula for the angle is a bit different from what I had in the previous slides. So the forward limit is different. So you find something that is 1/θ². So actually, this is dominated by, so the 1/θ², when you think about it, is like an effective 1/r² potential. It's not like 1/r, because 1/r is 1/θ². And when you think about that, it's actually dominated by a pole where you exchange, when you couple your particle and emits, so this is the photon pole that gives you an effective 1/r² potential. So, and this is interesting because you see, it's three-level physics, right? And at a small angle, this is a very different behavior, right? So now, think about the following fact. You have a big cube of water, with electrons, and hit by gravitational waves. You can expect that maybe you see the photons. You can maybe think that, you could think that maybe it could be an access to detect gravitons in a very specific way. It's certainly very difficult to detect a single graviton, for various reasons. But you see, this process tells you that a graviton giving you a photon is not, is allowed. And because of the 1/θ², if you can measure the forward scattering cross section, then there's maybe a chance that you make a difference between this event to over event, where the electron will be coupled to over photon through the standard Rutherford cross section. So I'm not claiming that this is the way you can detect a graviton, but this is an interesting consequence of a very simple three-level computation, right? So another way you can think about that as well is that if you have a photon that hits some charged matter, it emits a graviton, so you can think it could be a source somewhere of gravitational waves, okay? So, but the rate is very small, but anyway. What's happening here? Okay, it seems that I have a problem. What? It seems to be stuck, sorry. Okay. I'm sorry, there's something wrong with this. Doesn't want to go. Excuse me. I want to go. Yes. So we look at it with. Okay, so now that I've discussed the three-level case, let me discuss the one-loop amplitude. So the one-loop amplitude I want to construct through three-level gravitational amplitude that I've discussed through unitary ticket. So what I'm doing is that I'm going here to glue this amplitude I described. Integrate, so here is the loop momenta. I'm going to integrate over the loop momenta and sum over the various LCT configuration of the graviton across the cut. And as I said, I mean, of course, the construction is missing something. So, as people in the room know very well, but the things that I'm missing are not essential for what I'm looking for. It's not going to, for the square root and the log discontinuity I'm looking for that I described at the beginning of the talk, it's enough what I'm doing. So there are two kinds of contribution from my code. There's a singlet contribution where the elicity is the same and the non-singlet where the elicity are opposite. And what you see is that the singlet cut has, in that computation is very simple, and the non-singlet one has an expression that by power counting is what you expect, as 8 power of loop momenta in the numerator. And actually, if you are familiar with this computation in QED, you know it's a square. So the numerator is really the square of what you get in QED. So you can expand this amplitude on a basis of integral functions. So it's a one loop. I can expand it on a box. So I have boxes, and I will have triangles, and I will have bubbles. And the rest is not going to contribute to my infrared, so it's going to be UV. And in the non-relativistic limit, actually what I find that the boxes, if I have two massive particles, are multiplied by some power of the mass here. It's essentially dimension analysis that tells you. Now, what's happening is that this, when I have two massive particles here, the two triangles are the one I discussed at the beginning of the talk, so they will contain a classical contribution from here. So they will be square root mass over square root, M1 over square root of S, M2 divided by square root of S from here, and there will be log S. This guy will contribute to log S, so quantum part, and this one will contribute to log S. And the result is this. So the one loop, when you have two masses, you find 6 pi for the classical part, and quantum part minus 41 over 5 times log U squared. So this result, in particular the 41 over 5, had been already computed by John Donohue and Emile Biombon in the past, except that using unitarity method, it's very simple. And as I said, I mean, if you take the non-relativistic limit, that doesn't depend on the spin. Of course, I mean, if you have spin dependence, you have the multiple expansion, and that comes to contributions that are suppressed by 1 over the mass of the object. But the leading term is universal in terms of the spin of the object. So this is one aspect of the universality. The other universality is that it is independent of the UV. So this is what I'm saying. So if you know of the spin dependence, you can do the multiple expansion, and you can include that in the coefficient. So what I've given to you is the part that is proportional to the singlet, the spin. Now, this is, so in a sense, what you can do is that, now think about what we have been doing. So if you understand very well the low energy theorems in gravity that you can obtain in a way from the low energy theorem in QED, or in Young Mills through this KLT procedure, you deduce something about the structure of the effective action, right? So in a sense, at the end of the day, if you're interested about the classical physics, post-Newtonian expansion, and things like that, even coupling to spins dependence, there are coefficients in that effective action that will depend on the spin, on the velocity of the relative particle, that will be dictated completely by the low energy theorem. So in a sense, I mean, there are universal aspects of this, of the classical graviton physics that you can completely approach through amplitude computation and application of the low energy theorem on the gravitational side. I don't have time to discuss that, yeah, but I mean, it's a very interesting application of this. So. Now, the other thing that is important about that computation that I already commented is that we are in a sector that is independent of the high energy mode, so it only depends on the classical field contribution, so we don't have to worry about the UV part. Okay, so now what happens if I look, as I promised to you, at the case where I have a massive state, so the sun, and a massless state, like a photon. Actually, if you can, so you can do the computation for any massless states, that is spin 0, spin 1, spin 1 half. So you do the computation the same way, the relation between the trees and the Compton amplitude is the same as before. You have a decomposition on elementary integrals, but no, because you have an asymmetry between the two sides, it's massless and massive, there's only a massive triangle here, so the classical contribution from the triangle will come only from that side. And here, the one that has to do with the massless states will not give you the classical contribution. But nevertheless, what is interesting to notice when you do this sort of computation is that before you have even done anything, so you know you are going to have a decomposition of that form for this computation, you know that because of the relation between the various amplitude in the cut, you have BCG relations. And BCG relations tells you that what I call the coefficient of the box, are related to the coefficient of the triangle. So it's one way you can check that your computation is done correctly. So the coefficient of that box, that cross box, and the coefficient of the massless triangle, that is the triangle where there's the massless particle, have to satisfy this relation. And this is just a BCG relation. So in a sense, I mean, you know, this is where I'm telling you that you are going to simplify your life, I mean, by using everything you know, by doing this real-life computation. So if you expand really what you obtain, you find that actually there is the... So if I sum the tree and the one-loop contribution, so there is the tree contribution, so this is Q squared, so this is the momentum transfer, this is the mass of the sun, so omega is the energy of the photon, so this is what you expect at tree level. Then there is... So here, this is a quantum correction that contains a certain number. So this is the box, this is the triangle, and this is the bubble. And what I want to stress in that formula is that, okay, so there is a prefactor here in this amplitude, NS, that has to do with the type of the way you normalize your amplitude. So if you scatter a scalar, if you scatter a photon, or if you scatter a spin 1/2, the wave function is different. So there is some prefactor that comes from the nature of the spin of the object that you have scattered. So a scalar, the thing that comes from the wave function is 1. But if you have a photon, for example, you have something that depends on the helicity of the photon. Okay. Now, in that computation, what we noticed is that there is no helicity flip. So if you have a photon that is polarized with helicity plus, if it has a polarization plus, it has polarization, okay, if you orient in the same way. So there's no flip of helicity from in to out. Okay? So there is no birefringence. And that is kind of expected in a way, because the gravitational field doesn't have the possibility of flipping the helicity. It's very different from a computation done by Behrens and Gatzmann, or Drummond and Hartel, because they did quantum correction to the light bending, and they noticed that there is birefringence. But there is birefringence because there is coupling to the electron. So the photon couples to the matter, and because of that, you can flip the helicities. If you just are in the gravity sector, there is no way you can flip the helicity. So the amplitude is only non-vanishing if you have the plus plus and minus minus. That means no flip of helicities. So this is a trivial factor. So you see, the rest doesn't depend on the spin. So here, except for this one. So the coefficient of the bubble as a capital S, that means it's not the same for a scalar, for a photon, or for a spin 1/2. So if I now expand the function completely, what I'm getting is that I'm getting two classical bits. So here there is a massive triangle, so it's going to give me a classical contribution. This is this one. So this is the two classical part. So the relative number is exactly the one that you can check when you do the geodesic computation of the light bending the bending of the light by the sun. So this has to be the classical part. Here is the quantum part. So here, this is a purely imaginary part. So it doesn't contribute to the potential. So you don't have to worry about this one. So the only thing you have to focus is this. And as I said, there is a log S that comes from the bubble that depends on the spin. Everything else is spin independent. So it's going to be the same. So if I want to compare to some classical type of language, in a sense I want to compare to bending angle, so in a sense I have to be very careful in what I do because I've been scattering plane waves, so you have to make sure you know what you do when you talk about a classical quantity. So by using a formalism that was developed by Bohm, this is in his book, there is a way to go from this amplitude to the potential that is the Fourier transform of that amplitude, actually the real part of that amplitude because I don't include the dispersive part, and then from that getting the bending angle. So if you do that, what you find is that you find a bending angle that is the usual formula that you know from textbook and computed by Einstein 100 years ago, and you get here a correction that is essentially, that contains h bar. And here, everything is, as I said, universal in a sense. It doesn't depend on the spin, and this one depends on the spin. It's a number of spin dependent. So we are happy because the classical part reproduces what you expect. The quantum part are new. And what I want to insist on the fact is that the quantum part that you have here, it's not just explained about having a quantum corrected metric. So it's not something that you can... If you think about having a metric with quantum correction, so you have an effective metric, and looking at a geodesic in that effective metric, you can do that computation, but you don't get that. Because the effective metric contribution has to do with only, for example, looking at this part of the computation and having gravitons and loops here, so, and then you would have your probe in that. But the point is that our computation includes contributions that are not reducible to that, because we have, for example, I have this kind of graphs, and this graph that is not explained in terms of an effective metric computation. So in a sense, this quantum correction that is spin dependent is not something that you can explain, I don't know how to explain it, through a corrected geometry. So still, nevertheless, the computation, I think is right, so you can check it. The interesting thing is that if you look at the difference between the bending angle for a photon and a scalar or spin 1/2, whatever, so the two spins are different, you see it only focuses on that contribution. So, of course, this is ridiculously small compared to the classical contribution, but nevertheless, for the difference, the classical contribution cancels because it's, and then you are left with something that only depends on the quantum correction. So this is essentially what I wanted to present to you today, is that we can do this computation, which we play with pure gravity. We look at the consequences of having quantized the gravitational field, but we quantize as well the matter field. So we quantize everything because we compute a scattering amplitude. And we find something that seems to be a little at odds with what I would call the equivalence principle. Although it's not completely clear in that context, since a priori I have a completely quantum computation, the equivalence principle for me is very classical. It's about geodesics. So here, I'm not, so this dependence on the spin, I said, is not explained by a geodesic movement. It's not explained either by adding, because you can think about adding coupling to your effective action or your Lagrangian that depends on the spin. Okay, this is not explained by that. Because one way to see that it's not the case, I didn't give you the value, but actually, this doesn't depend on the LACT. So essentially, if you think about a minimal coupling between the spin operator and your and your Riemann tensor or whatever, then you will have something that will depend on the sign of your helicity, and this doesn't. So I don't quite know actually what is the interpretation really of that in terms of coupling to the effective action, but still it is in the amplitude. And at higher order in perturbation, the effect will be there, of course. I mean, it will be suppressed, but it seems to be a genuine effect. So now, what I just want to say is that, I mean, it gives you up. I mean, actually, this sort of computation teaches you two things. So it teaches you the fact that you can discover interesting new phenomena, very simple phenomena in quantum gravity, and some of them, I didn't know before I was doing. I did that computation. So. But the other thing that I like a lot is the fact that there's this classical part in the amplitude computation, and that we can get through amplitude method. I mean, it's not for free, but still, it's not that difficult in a way. And the low energy frame that we have tells something about the structure of the post-Newtonian correction that we have between interacting particle in the non-relativistic limit. And that has not been really studied completely, and I think it's an exciting application of all the amplitude method that we have been learning and developing. So, thank you. I mean, the computation here, yeah, I mean, it's done for scalar and electrons, so it's, so the DV, so if I draw, so, okay, are you asking about massless object or not?
This
is for massless. So if you have massive, if your scalar or your electron are massive, there's no difference. I mean, this is for massless. It's only for the massless case that you have a spin dependence. Okay. In the massive case, in the leading order, in the mass expansion. So this is what I said about the cross section. It's universal, so it doesn't depend on the spin. So of course, if you have an electron, then you have the multiple expansion. So you will have a coupling with the spin of the electron, but it's the traditional. It's exactly what you expect from this. Okay, so then the division is given by this. It's very small. Of course, it's very small. 10 to the minus 60.
10 to the minus 60.
It's essentially, so it's 1 over, okay, it's impact parameter cube, because you have to use the impact parameter, which is the gauge invariant quantity, and it is L Planck square times Schwarzschild radius. So, in a sense, for the sun, I mean, it's ridiculous. So if you can think about a white dwarf or something like that, where you can have the impact parameter that is something like almost the Schwarzschild radius, so you can gain a little bit. But essentially, the best you can do by looking at massive compact object is something that is L Planck divided by a Schwarzschild radius square. I mean, so it's a killer, right? So I'm not claiming that it's something that if I'm not going to go to the Cassini people and tell them you could shoot. But the fact that there is this spin dependence, I think, is an interesting fact. The fact as well that for me was interesting in that computation is to see the effect of the birefringence, because there is a lot of discussion about birefringence effect and gravity rainbow, whatever. So if you don't include matter in the loop, you don't see this sort of effect. Gravity doesn't induce that. Which I think is an interesting part of the computation.
How much harder is tubes?
Well, it's difficult to say always that something is almost finished, but that will be, yeah, Ludovic has collected all the pieces of the two-loop amplitude, so there's an expression in terms of integrals and things like that, so we are at the phase of the integral reduction, looking at the non-relativistic limit, so that will be in his PhD thesis. It's essentially done. I mean, what In a sense, I mean, it's the path is straightforward, except that it's just there's no really conceptual issues that we have, just technical.